Toyota's GR Yaris has become an incredibly popular platform in the tuner market. I'm here with Charles from Lamspeed, owner of currently the world's fastest GR Yaris, running as quick as 960 at 155 miles an hour. Now, Charles, this is a 1.6 litre, three-cylinder engine. I'm pretty convinced that Toyota never expected it to be running this quick. Why is this platform so good and why can it support so much power?
We've developed it from the very beginning. Every little hurdle which we've come across, everyone's going to have issues. Like we have our own issues as well. Once we find the limit of a certain part or issue of the platform, then we just pretty much go out, develop and manufacture like a upgraded solution, test it on our own car, and then from there all our customers are able to purchase it.
So you haven't sort of approached this from a let's throw the kitchen sink at it with every part that we think might need upgrading. You've gone through in a more scientific approach and just found parts where their limits or failure points are.
Of course. Like say for example, one of the very first things which we ran into was the head sealing issue, right? Back in 2022, there was no head studs made, right? So we were starting lifting heads around the circuit, right? So from there, we approached companies like ARP to manufacture. Well, we pretty much sent ARP all the specs which we needed. ARP manufactured us some head studs. We put them in with the factory head gasket. It's been pretty good. And from there, we would hit issues such as the factory head gasket, and then from there, we'll just upgrade it from there.
I'm interested, when you're kind of getting in on the ground floor with a brand new platform and developing it, you go to a manufacturer like ARP and say, hey, we need a set of head studs. At that point, giving them all of those specs, are they making a head stud specifically for you that you're selling through your brand? Then what happens? Do they come in later on and say, hey, actually, you know what? This is a really popular product. We're getting asked all the time. And then they kind of steal your thunder and make their own. How does that work?
Look, I did have a bad feeling about it. However, it is what it is. Sometimes things get copied and you can't really do anything about it. But if you need the part, it is what it is. You just have to bite the bullet.
Let's just take a step back here. So it's a 1.6 litre three-cylinder engine. What is the power in stock form? And then if we take things to extreme, what power level are you at now in order to run 9.6, 155 mile an hour?
So at the wheels, right, they probably make about the 140 to 150 kilowatts. We currently, what's that in horsepower? I don't even know.
I can't do that in my head. Let's just work in kilowatts. Other people can figure it out.
But at the moment to run 960, we're currently making about 880 horsepower at the wheels.
Okay, that's a substantial jump forward, even if we're not necessarily converting between kilowatts and horsepower here on the fly. Okay, so I mean, even in stock form, one of the great things about tuning a turbocharged factory engine is that almost always there's a little bit of headroom left. A little bit of power to be gained by tuning it, by increasing the boost pressure. So how far can you take that sort of 140, 145 kilowatts in stock form?
Look, on my personal car, we went probably I think it was 270 kilowatts when we ran the 1050, completely standard engine, standard cams, just with valve springs, standard head gasket, standard head bolts. That particular recipe has been passed on to other customers around the world. And they're still running mid to high tens with completely factory engine.
That's pretty impressive for a stock engine. Normally that's going to require a fairly comprehensive upgrade with pistons and connecting rods and just about all manner of upgrades.
Usually, but I guess if the tune's spot on, it'll last. We've got a customer's car, Wesley Tang's. His setup on a standard engine has been about 2 years now. Right, and that does street, drags, and circuit.
That's definitely impressive. Obviously, in order to get any of this unlocked power out of it, no matter how far you're going, you need a tuning solution.
Of course.
What have you gone to there? And is the reflashing and aftermarket solutions?
We haven't done any reflashing at this stage. It's more MoTeC, and that's all looked after by Phil from Armour Motorsports. So he chooses my personal car and all my customers' cars.
Now, as I understand it as well, MoTeC have made this a little bit more straightforward in that they've brought out a plug-and-play ECU package with firmware specifically set up for the GR Yaris.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, pretty much. It's a plug-and-play. Only small downside, if you're really worried about it, is the radar control, but yeah.
So you're talking here, you lose the benefit of the radar-based cruise control.
Correct, yeah.
One of the nice functions with this particular engine is that it incorporates both direct injection and port injection. And one of the great things about direct injection is the advantages it gives, mainly for OEs in terms of emissions and efficiency, but very limiting for us in the aftermarket because it's not as easy as just switching in a larger set of direct injectors. It doesn't quite work like that.
Yep.
But with the addition of the port injectors, you can then keep the factory direct injection and simply fit larger injectors to suit the power range?
Yeah, of course. Like even with our fuel rail that comes with our billet in that manifold, you can pretty much fit like any EV14 injector into it. So we've got 2,600 cc's in there.
In terms of what you've needed to do to the engine in this particular car, can you go through? Obviously, that's a little bit more than just a set of head studs and a head gasket.
Yeah, that's right. We've pretty much got a custom set of rods and pistons manufactured to for us by Carrillo and CP. Standard crankshaft, standard rod bearings and main bearings. Yeah.
There's a very limited number of upgrades given the massive power level.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. It's very basic. A lot of people think that you have to throw everything at it. Nah, not really.
Yeah. All right. So the bottom end of the engine, the crankshaft, the pistons and the rods are really there mainly just to support the higher power level.
Yep.
How about the cylinder head? And, you know, cylinder head cams, that's really about getting the airflow in and out, obviously in conjunction with the turbocharger. What's been done to the head?
Last year for circuit, it was a completely standard head with just Kilford valve springs, retainers and camshafts. It was a pretty mild set of cams. Then we hit a limit, all right? And so now for drag racing, we've got a ported head, bigger cams and, even better hit like valve springs and like the retainers for like Kilford as well.
I'm not sure if you've done this as a back-to-back test, but could you give us an idea if you have of what sort of benefit maybe just the likes of the ported head on its own gave you?
We were capped at about 700 horsepower, all right? We added more boost and nothing really happened, all right? Bottlenecked, but ported head on and slightly bigger cams and we picked up 180 horsepower.
Okay, that's not a small improvement. Well, we can see at that point, yes, massive improvement for that set of modifications. Yeah. A lot of this is also going to come down to the turbo that you select.
Of course.
In this case, the car is dual purpose. You're using it for circuit racing.
Yep.
I believe last year it was fourth in club sprint here at World Time Attack. What do you do with turbo sizing for those two disciplines?
For circuit racing last year, we had a Garrett G30 770. We actually ran a 9.8 with that turbo in complete circuit trim, circuit suspension and everything. All right. And recently we've changed quite a few things and we've gone 9.6. However, the car wasn't at its optimal stage. Like it wasn't going straight and yeah.
So there's more in it is what you're saying?
Yeah, soon.
Coming back to that sort of circuit spec, I'm picking here if you've only done rods and pistons, I'm guessing you probably haven't been able to really get much of an increase, if anything, in terms of capacity. That's a big turbo, a lot of power for a 1.6 litre engine. What is the sort of usable power band on the racetrack?
On the circuit setup, pretty much there's power everywhere from about 4 grand to 8,500.
That's much wider than I'd think. What is it about this little 1.6 litre engine that allows it to spool a relatively big turbo so well?
With the variable like cam timing and the just Phil works his magic and it does what it needs to be done. Yeah.
So you're basically able to get the best of both worlds, low end performance and still huge numbers up top.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
All right. My next obvious question here is how on earth do you hold the drivetrain together with that much power? Can you go through what you've needed to change there?
So in early stages of development, when the car was pretty much standard at 240 kilowatts, we broke the fifth gear hub sleeve on the factory gearbox. from there, it was pretty close to World Time Attack, and we just bit the bullet, went straight to a H pattern, a dog box. Yeah. And from there, at this stage, it's got a Kotouc 7-speed sequential.
Yeah, 7-speed sequential box. Okay, that sounds like probably a fairly pricey upgrade in order to get reliability. Yeah. I'm just interested as well with, again, you're a pretty early mover with this platform. You talked about the ARP head studs before. Yeah. You know, were you sort of driving the development of the aftermarket gearbox options as well?
Yep. I have tried the Drenth, which is also a very good, like sequential. We ran the 9.8 with the Drenth. So I've actually tried like many other manufacturers as well, just pretty much for my own experience.
So you're developing this essentially to pass this experience on to your customers so that they're winning as well.
Yep, exactly.
Okay, what about the rest of the drivetrain components? You've got a transfer case, I'm guessing, here as well as a rear differential and also axles. How reliable are those components?
So far, we haven't broken anything. It's got a standard transfer case, standard axles, and a standard rear diff with just LSDs for traction around the circuit, and our billet cover for the rear diff, just to keep temps down. But that's got not really relevant for like drag racing. Yeah.
That is really impressive that it'll hold up to that sort of power level. I mean, I guess, where do you see this going? How far can you push this?
Yeah.
Have you got an idea of where you're likely to see the next failure? I mean, is the engine block reliability and crankshaft reliability likely to come up as an issue?
We're same with everything. Everything's got its own limit, but for now, we're running on like the same bottom end for 2 years now, and we haven't reached the limit yet. So I'm not too sure, but the main thing is just to have spares ready to go. That's about it.
On that note though, how do you sort of approach the tuning philosophy? I understand obviously you're not actually on the laptop yourself, but in terms of in conjunction with your tuner, how are you deciding sort of how you take the next step? Sort of how aggressive are you with this, or has it just been very sort of gradual iterative improvements?
No, it's always like small improvements, right? So I work pretty closely with Phil, and Phil tells me, look, you're slowly running out of fuel, or this needs to be changed, and then we just work slowly from there. So say, for example, we originally released a surge tank kit to supply more fuel. It was only until, I think, start of this year, where we've changed from a Walbro 525 to a brushless pump. So now we're like the pump's rated for 2,000 horsepower, more than enough.
When it comes to the drag racing side of the equation, it's obviously not just about making massive amounts of power. It's also about getting that power to the track.
Yep.
So it sort of is a bit of a balancing act. I mean, on this platform with the current tire on it, is it likely that given enough power, you could see this dipping into the eights? I mean, that is obviously a lifetime away from a 9.6, but I'm just interested, do you think that's realistic?
I believe it is realistic, and that is the goal. All right, touch wood, I don't want to jinx or anything. I haven't really told too many people. Like,
oh, don't worry, not too many people will be watching this.
pretty much. But yeah, that is the goal.
Okay.
We do have pretty much backup contingencies if we do come close and we don't quite get there. But that's all in theory on paper, but whether it works in real life is a different story.
Well, certainly an exciting goal, and I'll be interested to follow and see how you get on with that aim. If people are in the market for some of the components that you offer for this platform, how are they best to get in touch?
You can just visit my website, lamspeedracing.com, or Instagram, or just send me an email through the website. Pretty much everything which we offer is on the website. Yeah.
Great. Thanks for the chat. Really great to find out just how impressive this little platform is. And again, we look forward to seeing you be the first into the eights.
Thank you.
like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.